Good morning. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to today's webinar on Kisumu Sustainable Mobility Plan. Rehab Mudara is going to be our moderator today, but she's still having a bit of issues with connecting, but she should join us very soon. Sule, you're on board.
I am, engineer.
Okay, karibu sana. We are going to start with you. Please give your opening remarks. I'm hoping that Madam City Manager will be able to join us. Thank you.
Good engineer. The chair of, I can see the chair of infrastructure planning and housing, Professor Larry. Our engineers are from different agencies. Expecting other learning, higher learning institutions, academia is also to join. My colleagues, I wish to welcome you to today's presentation. This is a culmination of various meetings that have been held by ITDP. ITDP was consulted by Ford Foundation following the successful completion of integrated strategic urban development plan for the city, which recommended that we then formulate the transport plan for Kisumu. The transport plan for Kisumu also is looking at the implementation of sustainable urban development goals. And that is goal number 3, 8, 9, 10, 11, 13, and 19. And also looking at having cities that are transport oriented, which we commonly refer to as OTD. This is again anchored into our new local physical land use development plans. This journey started way back in 2016 when in September, when we had our first engagement. And the notice for the intention to plan was then put on two dailies as required by law on the 10th May 2018. Our first stakeholders meeting following that was held in June at Sumo Social Hall. Then the third meeting was held on 20th November 2018 at Acacia. We had a series of other meetings. For us to get here, the consultants did conduct surveys, and part of the surveys were household surveys. We did several traffic count on major roads, and also did engage with the various departments of the city and without the city. And today we are glad then to introduce this consultant who is ITDP to make to you the presentation on what is coming out from their plan. And with this, I wish to invite Engineer Njeri to take us through.
Thank you so much, Banasule. I'm going to project the presentation just in a few You can see my my presentation.
Yes, yes, engineer, go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, Bonasule. And thank you, everybody who has been able to attend today's webinar. We are going to take you through the Sustainable Mobility Plan. We'll take you through the surveys which were done, the findings, and the mobility plan itself, just the highlights of the mobility plan. And then after that, we are going to have a short break, and then we'll have question and answer session. I'll start by introducing ITDP. ITDP stands for Institute for Transportation and Development Policy. We are working throughout the world, dealing with the sustainable and inclusive transport. We have offices in Nairobi here, which is the Africa office. We have Mexico office. We have other offices in Brazil, in China, in New York City, where our headquarters are based. Coming to the Kisumu Sustainable Mobility Plan, this plan, the development of this plan started way back, as Plan Asule has indicated, in 2016, when the surveys were conducted, the household surveys and other surveys to establish the existing conditions on matters transportation in Kisumu. So the Kisumu Sustainable Mobility Plan is the first comprehensive transport plan, master plan for Kisumu. It's a 10-year plan, and it comes under the umbrella of the Integrated Sustainable Urban Mobility, Urban Development Plan, the ISUD for Kisumu. The main goal for the Kisumu SAMP is to provide efficient, affordable, equitable, safe, and convenient mobility for all the residents of Kisumu. And it was developed with the support from the Ford Foundation and also the International Climate Initiative, that is IKI. The process of the development of the SAMP started with the baseline data collection and identifying the existing transportation challenges that exist. Then it went to the development of the transport vision, the goals and the indicators. And this process has involved a lot of public participation, stakeholder engagement, as Plan Asule has mentioned. Then together with the county and the stakeholders, there has been a selection of priority projects which are geared towards meeting the transportation goals in the plan. And then the plan has also come up with the implementation plan and also a monitoring and evaluation framework. The surveys which were done included pedestrian counts. At least 12 locations in Kisumu City were covered, counting the number of pedestrians per hour, per direction. And then for the public transport, ITDP did frequency occupancy counts. In addition, there was frequency, occupancy by gender, just to get a feel of how many men versus women are moving in various modes of transport. There was a public transport inventory, and 25 samples were done. There were traffic counts, pedestrian facility inventory, just to find out what kind of NMT facilities were available at that time, that is 2016. The parking occupancy, to what extent is there available on-street parking being used? The street lighting inventory, street vendor mapping, transport operator focus groups. The ITDP had several meetings with the transport operators, the bicycle border borders, the motorcycle border borders, the tuk-tuks, the matatu operators. Then there was a big survey, the household survey, that covered 2,762 households. The stakeholder engagement started in March 2016, when there was a street design workshop held at the Kisumu City Hall, I believe. And ITDP had invited one of the gurus in street design. And the participants were taken through the complete street designs. The other stakeholder engagement was held at in Kisumu, and there were many participants involved. There were consulting firms, the county government of Kisumu, civil society, or other organizations, educational institutions, private sector, parastatals, public sector, or public transport operators. And that was held on 15th September of 2016. You can see Planner Sule there, I think, is the one presenting something or asking a question. Then we had, in 2018, we had several stakeholder engagement. One was at Acacia on June 20th, 2018. And again, we had quite a number of participants cutting across educational institutions, private sector, parastatals, the transport sector. Yeah. Another one was held on 20th November 2018. This one had very many participants, 106 participants. And we were glad to have His Excellency the Governor of Kisumu attending the session. And he gave his remarks. So out of all the surveys that were done, I'm going to take you through the findings of the survey on the existing conditions and what the people of Kisumu how they talked about the existing conditions and their pressing needs as far as mobility is concerned. So from the studies, it was established that 53% of the people in Kisumu walk on a daily basis. And the other 47%, there is 13% who use the matatus. We have about 13% who are using motorcycles, and others use other modes of transport, and only 6% use cars for their daily commute. So you can see most of the people are actually walking on a daily basis. 53% of Kisumu residents are walking on a daily basis. ITTP went further and tried to establish out of how women move around and how men move around on a daily basis. And it was established that 60% of women walk on a daily basis, while 40% of the men walk. That means a higher percentage of women are walking on a daily basis. Most women walk, while about 40% of the men walk. So the men are using other modes of transport more than the women. Another finding was that you find that most of the women, you find that, first of all, less women are moving around than men. Less women are traveling than men. More men are moving around. And you find that very few women are using cycling. Majority of the cyclists are men. There are more women who are walking, using tuk-tuks and matatus. But the men are generally using all modes of transport. The most accessible mode of transport was found to be border borders and public transport. But most people felt that footpaths and street lighting were lacking. When the ITDP did the counts, the pedestrians per hour on various streets, it was found that within the city center, Achieng Oneko had the highest number of pedestrians walking, 2,300 pedestrians per hour. As you can see in those numbers, you find that Nairobi Highway also had a huge number of pedestrians walking, 2,200 pedestrians per hour. So this means that you are standing somewhere and you count 2,200 pedestrians in an hour. So that's a very high number of pedestrians. And also, you can see that the city center now has a number of high quality footpaths, and the pedestrians are enjoying themselves. Others are relaxing on the street. That is part of the Triangle project, which has just been completed. But in other parts of Kisumu, we have challenges with the footpaths. And the studies established that many parts, you can see only the green sections have good footpaths. And the second map shows that even fewer of those footpaths are more than have a minimum width of 2 meters. So very few streets in Kisumu have the required footpaths, and especially the minimum width of 2 meters. And you can see from this photo, this is Kibos Road. The carriageway is well done, but the walking facilities are not available, and people just have to walk on dirt. And it's very unsafe for people to be walking where there are no proper facilities for walking. This is Nairobi Highway. You can see the pedestrians are supposed to walk on the stormwater drainage, but you can see some covers have collapsed. And this is a very big drain for, if you know this section of this road, this is a huge drain. And it makes walking very uncomfortable and unsafe. And apparently, this is not the only section where the covers have collapsed into the drain. Again, in other areas, you'll find that they are very wide intersections. And these very wide intersections make it very difficult for, or very unsafe for pedestrians to cross the roads, because the vehicles tend to move very fast. If you have tried to cross such areas, you'll find that you almost have to run for your life, because it's very dangerous. Vehicles are speeding and there are no crossing facilities. Again, this is Nairobi Highway. You find that the NMT, which is provided, has been encroached by motorized traffic, and especially the border borders. I remember one time we were walking on this footpath, and it was actually so difficult to walk on that footpath because there are so many border borders all over the place, and you feel very unsafe. And you can see the number of people who are walking are very many. So we need to make it safer for our people to move around. This is Kisumu bypass. You'll find that the community has actually had to try and erect a temporary bump to try and slow down the motorized traffic, the border borders, so that the pedestrians can be able to move around and be able to cross this facility, which looks like an NMT, but it's being used like a part of the carriageway. Another area you can see, this is Nairobi Road. The lanes are very wide, and pedestrians like these school children have to cross very wide sections of the road. There are no crossing facilities, and it is very unsafe because the vehicles are moving very fast. You can imagine if your child has to cross this road every morning and every evening, it is really unsafe. And chances of getting an accident are very high. Further studies and analyzing the NTSA data revealed that Kisumu, this Nairobi Highway and Kisumu Busia Highway have the highest number of crashes and fatalities on the road. So most of the black spots are located along the main Kenha corridors. So it's very important that the right safety facilities are included on these corridors. On interviewing the residents on walkability, most people felt that the most pressing issues are better footpaths, safer crossings, and better lighting. So it is very important that some of these things are addressed in the plan. On cyclists, counting the number of people who are cycling, the studies indicated that most of the cyclists were found on Dieck Highway with 340 cyclists per hour, and also in the CBD, Ochieng Oneko had a very high number of 220. And also Ring Road, Nyalenda also had quite a high number of 230 cyclists. So this can help us or has assisted in identifying the corridors for cycling. And you can see some of the existing challenges is that this is Kibos Road. You find that cyclists, because there are no facilities for cycling, you know, there's no cycle track, there's no footpath. The cyclists, the NMT users are left with no choice but to use the carriageway, which is not safe for them. This is Busia Road. Busia Road has a very nice NMT wide, and you can see if people are walking very safely, and also they're sharing with the cyclists, and the space is adequate, and this promotes their safety. So the plan envisages a situation where all the roads have this kind of facilities for all the road users. It is possible to come up with the fast and simple retrofits that can improve safety for pedestrians. Like this is Jomo Kenyatta Highway in the CBD. It was part of the Triangle Project. And you can see it's actually very possible to take part of the, like the wider lanes and create cycle tracks, safe cycle tracks. And people are able to start using the cycle tracks. And it's not too expensive to retrofit this kind of cycle tracks. And they can start using them almost immediately. This can happen in most of the city. And like now, when we have COVID issues, you can have, and many people are concerned about using public transport. We don't want people to start using their, maybe those ones who have cars, to start using their cars. Instead, we can encourage more people to start cycling by providing safe cycle tracks. The studies established that there are quite a number of parking facilities, although there is no standard design for parking facilities for cycles. And the plan recognizes that and has identified more locations for cycling facilities. So on improving cycling, the respondents felt that separate cycle tracks are very necessary to improve their safety, better lighting, again, to improve their safety and security, and better road condition. So those are the issues which are the most pressing to the people who are cycling in Kisumu. You can see that when Ring Road, Nyalenda, when the street lights were put, this improves the safety of the pedestrians and the cyclists. And you can see quite a number of people walking on the street. So it's very important that our streets are well lit so that more people feel safe when they are walking on the street. But you find that most of the streets in Kisumu are not well lit. Only the green streets are well lit. They have good lights. But all the red streets have no street lighting, including even Nairobi Road and Kisumu, Busia Road, and even the bypass. But I hope this has improved over time, because this study was done in 2016. Some of these areas maybe some street lighting have been put since. For public transport, the studies established that Kenyatta Highway, and especially from Kisumu Boys towards Mamboleo, and especially up to the bypass, that is the section with the highest number of public transport passengers, with 4,500 passengers per hour per direction. Kibos Road was found to have 2,500 passengers per hour per direction. And also the Nairobi Highway had quite a high number of people traveling in public transport. But when you compare the amount, the number of passengers traveling by public transport compared to the amount of road space provided for public transport, you find that the road space provided for the public transport is only 30%, but the number of passengers who are using public transport on a particular road is about 68%. So we need to correct this kind of situation so that the public transport is provided adequate space on the road, so that we can be able to transport the masses on the road. The public transport routes, the studies establish that the matatus are able to cover longer distances up to Maseno, Kiboswa, Gita, and even to Ahero, while the tuk-tuks cover shorter routes, and especially in the informal settlements, Nyamasaria, Kondele. We also have some tuk-tuks reaching Riat and Simba. So when it comes to establishing the public transport routes, these studies can guide the process. The studies also established that while quite a large section of Kisumu has access to public transport, there are areas which are not covered by public transport, and especially the areas of Obunga and Eastern Manyata. I believe these are some of the informal settlements in Kisumu. And there is need to extend the public transport so that all the areas are well covered by public transport system. So some of the issues which were raised, the operators felt that there were many safety challenges. They were also having to work long hours, and especially the drivers and the conductors, without rest, which makes it very unsafe for them to be operating the vehicles, like driving for very long hours. Makes somebody can even start sleeping on the wheel. Then another issue which was established was a dilapidated vehicle fleet. Most of the matatus are quite old. They are polluting the environment. They are not comfortable for the passengers. It's also the manual fare collection. And especially like now when we have COVID, the manual fare collection is can add to the transmission of the COVID-19. Lack of terminals and bus shelters was also noted as a key challenge. You find that most of the matatus park on the roadside because there are no terminals and there are no bus shelters. So the passengers wait in the sun, or when it's raining, they are being rained on. So you can see there, the matatus, the public transport, have to wait on the carriageway. And this adds to the congestion. So there is need to think about providing the facilities for the matatus, the matatu terminals. Also the tuk-tuks, they are operating on the roadside. And you find that even sometimes they are operating on the NMT facilities, making it very difficult for the people who are using the NMTs. So on improving public transport, the residents of Kisumu felt that the most challenging issue is the waiting time in the matatus. They have to wait for very long periods of time before a matatu gets full. And that they felt that was a big challenge. They also felt that overcrowding was an issue, and the public transport is not safe enough. For the cycle borders, the studies established that there are a high number of cycle borders in Kisumu, but there are no provision for the cycle tracks, adequate cycle tracks, or even a shaded stage, or a place where they can rest and wait for the passengers without getting scorched by the sun, the hot sun in Kisumu. For the borders, the numbers are growing very rapidly. And it's not only in Kisumu, even in Nairobi and other upcoming towns in Kenya, the number of borders are becoming very high. Why? One of the reasons is that we do not have adequate public transport. Also, the congestion in our cities make the borders quite popular because they can be able to move very fast, even in public, in very congested roads. But people felt that the borders are not safe. And indeed, it has been established that borders cause a lot of accidents, and we end up with a lot of fatalities and injuries on the roads. Another thing is that people felt that there was limited helmet use. There are lack of designated waiting facilities. That was raised by the border operators. It has been noted that most of the criminal activities involve border riders. That is another issue that the study was able to establish. This map shows the locations where the borders, the waiting areas for the borders, the cycle borders, and the motorcycle borders. So the motorcycle borders are shown in purple, and the cycle borders are shown in green. So the respondents felt that there is an urgent need for enforcement of helmets for passengers to make it safer to ride on a boda-boda. And also there's a need for safe driving by the boda-boda drivers. You find that they sometimes move very fast and they don't always obey the traffic code. So most of the residents felt that this needs to be enforced. Another thing that came out is that the drivers need to be identified. There should be a way of identifying the drivers so that this also should improve the safety of the pillion passengers. We could come up with a way of identifying the driver by having maybe a name on their t-shirt or their helmet. Yeah, so that we improve the safety of passengers. On street parking, it was established that the study wanted to find out whether how much parking is available and how much of it is fully, or to what extent the available parking is being utilized. And the blue, the streets marked in blue are showing the gazetted streets in Kisumu. And there are many streets which are actually not gazetted for parking. For parking occupancy, only the red streets and the orange streets have higher than 100% occupancy. The green streets, and you can see there are quite many, have below 50% occupancy. So what this means is that we have allocated a lot of space for vehicle parking, and most of it is actually underutilized. And it's taking up a lot of space for NMT. So most of this space can actually be reclaimed for NMT, and you still have adequate space for vehicles to park in the city. The parking fee collection, it was established that there is a digital a system of parking charges collection. And you find that most of the parking fees is charged on a daily rate. But we need to move to a situation where this can be charged. We can charge per hour, per vehicle, so that the city is able to collect as much revenue from parking as possible. You don't want a person parking a whole 8 hours or even more, and they're only paying 100 shillings. There's need for a rate per hour, so that you park based on the amount of time you use the parking space. Another observation is that some of the spaces which are being used for parking are prime spaces, which can be converted into beautiful spaces for public. You find that there are very many people who would like to use, if you go to the park, you find there are very many people who would appreciate a very nice place for them to rest, to meet. I saw there are normally so many meetings in the park. And some of these spaces can actually be converted into some nice public spaces in the city. Another issue is encroachment of motorized traffic on the NMT. You can see this is a footpath, but there are so many vehicles which are parked on the footpath. And you can see that pedestrian there has to walk on the carriageway because his space has been taken by the vehicles. So this is another area that needs to be addressed. So I'll hand over to Chris, Director Africa, to take us through the vision and goals. And then Gitao will take us through the rest of the presentation. Thank you very much.
Great. Thanks a lot, Engineer Njeri. And I'll pick up there on the vision and goals section. So based on all the findings as we're going through the city and analyzing the data, we came up with some goals for the city to try to shape the proposals and make sure that we're clear on the direction that we want to take in the future. So an initial part of that was looking at what kind of scenarios could happen in the city over the coming years. You know, if we continue with the present course, you know, we're likely to see more of the same trends, right? So more and more people using private vehicles, probably expanding Boda Boda use. And if we assume a growth rate of about 6 or 7% per year, we'd see a near doubling in the use of private vehicles over the next 10 years. And along with it, associated issues, you know, growing congestion, higher pollution, and so on. And so we said, what if, on the other hand, we move toward a more sustainable scenario where we aim to actually, you know, maintain the private vehicle use at no more than 10% above the absolute levels today, and make sure that we expand the walking, cycling, public transport facilities enough to accommodate those new trips on those modes instead. And so we would propose that that's a much better scenario for the city because we can, you know, provide mobility for the citizens at a much lower cost and with lower safety and environmental impacts than we'd have under the business as usual scenario, okay? So here are the mode splits that you would see under those scenarios. So, you know, the existing split under business as usual, walking and cycling would probably decline. Public transport would even probably lose some passengers to private taxi services and cars. And in the more sustainable scenario, we try to maintain the pedestrian mode share, grow cycling, right? Because there's a lot of potential in Kisumu to have more cycle trips if we have the infrastructure for it. And making sure that public transport can also carry more passengers than it does today. So those are the mode split scenarios. And that led to this vision that the city should have high quality, affordable, and user-friendly public transport integrated with walking and cycling networks to enhance access for all residents. Okay, and so this vision really underlies a lot of the proposals that I'm going to talk about in the coming slides. And then to make that concrete, you know, we need to have quantitative time-bound targets so that we can track the progress toward the mobility plan goals over time. Okay, so the plan lays out a number of targets for, you know, for each sector. So, you know, maintaining and increasing the NMT mode share, making sure that we have, a growing share of trips on public transport, making sure that people have good public transport access, right? Because that's going to drive the use of public transport. And then having an explicit goal of you know, maintaining our vehicle kilometers traveled by private vehicles no more than 10% above the current levels. And this should help us improve road safety and also air quality. And it's in line with goals like the ones laid out in the National Climate Change Action Plan that Kenya has adopted recently. So those are the targets, and then let's get into some of the specific initiatives that can get us there, right? And we have to make sure that, you know, whatever goals, if we're, you know, if we're setting a goal of increased public transport trips, for instance, we need to make sure that the proposals that we include actually help get us there, you know, that we have enough buses to carry the people for that increased public transport mode share. So let's get into the proposals. This is a summary. So the first section is non-motorized transport improvements, so walking and cycling network, then public transport. The plan also talks about vending management, and then street lighting, stormwater, the need for much better parking management to help manage the number of trips by private vehicles. And then finally, we need to look at how we can do a better job with land use transport integration so that we're supporting the use of sustainable modes through the land use policies. Okay, so to dive into those first, we have the NMT improvements. So this map shows the complete NMT network that we'd achieve at the end of the day. And this is comprised of a few components. So one is having about 100 kilometers of pedestrian, you know, good pedestrian facilities. So this could be either good footpaths or shared space on narrower streets. And then out of the 100 kilometers, about 31 kilometers are on wide streets that need cycle tracks. You know, they have fast enough traffic, heavy enough vehicle volumes that they need to have separate space for cycling. There's an opportunity to create a high quality greenway along the lakefront. And then on the Kenha corridors that Engineer and Jerry talked about in the last section, you know, we need to really look at how to improve safety on those streets. That's urgent. You know, these streets are seeing, you know, most of the injuries and fatalities in the city. So it's really important that we address that. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a bit. So, and then finally, the school zone safety improvements. This is something that we can do quickly to improve safety near the majority of schools in the city. So let's go into those a bit. As I mentioned, you know, the pedestrian realm can take different forms on different types of streets. You know, on wider streets, it would mean having separate footpaths, having safe crossings with traffic calming or signals. But on narrow streets, it can be a matter of having a good shared space design, you know, so there's enough traffic calming to reduce the motor vehicle speeds to 15 kilometers per hour so that people, you know, pedestrians, cyclists, and vehicles can safely mix. So on the larger streets, we need to have proper walkways. And this is what the city has already started demonstrating in the Kisumu Triangle project, where wide footpaths have been created on Jomo Kenyatta, on Angawa and Ogingo Dinga Street. And we can expand that you know, kind of high quality footpath to many more streets in the city. So they need to be designed according to the zone system, you know, with a separate pedestrian zone that should usually be at least 2 meters to provide enough clear space for walking. Here's an example that can make our streets more accessible and ensure that the furniture and other elements are clear of the space that pedestrians use. And then there are other standards. I'm just showing an excerpt here from the street design manual for urban areas in Kenya, which is currently in draft form and we hope will be adopted soon, which can guide a lot of the detailed design work on our footpaths to ensure that we have, you know, adequate elements like bollards to keep the vehicles off slopes, ramp slopes at the corners so that the footpaths are completely accessible. And so you can refer to that manual for more details, but that we need to start following these standards for all the upcoming footpath projects. And here's an example of what we want to achieve, you know, having very smooth ramps and good finishing with the materials so that the walking and cycling facilities are fully accessible. Okay. And then we have the cycling network. So this combines the 31 kilometers of streets that would have new cycle tracks with the Kenha corridors where there should be the safety retrofits to ensure that cyclists can use those corridors as well. And if you combine those two elements, you can come up with this complete network that provides pretty good cycle access on all of the larger streets in the city. Okay. And this is what we should try to achieve with those cycle tracks, you know, having sufficient clear width, they should be physically separated from mixed traffic, and the adjoining footpaths should be wide enough so that pedestrians don't spill into the cycle track. Okay, so those are all the ingredients that can help create cycling, you know, a good cycle network and ensure that we can actually achieve that increase in the cycle mode share in the city. Okay, then we get to the Kenha corridor safety retrofits. So there are a couple of components here. One is that we need to have some elements throughout these corridors. So we need to have safe crossings, we need to have traffic calming, we need to have bollards, so that the spaces that are meant for pedestrians and cyclists actually stay exclusively for the use of non-motorized transport. And then there are about 20 intersections, major intersections along these corridors that can be improved, okay? And you know, they can incorporate measures like tighter turning radii, safer crossings. In some cases, they may require signalization, but this can help ensure that all of these intersections you know, have better safety and we address the key black spots in the city. Okay. Now for the crossings, you know, the response that's often given is, why don't we just build footbridges? There are a lot of issues with these footbridges. You know, they increase travel time and distance. They're not accessible. Even if you put a ramp, they're not easy for people with disabilities to use. And they're often dangerous at night. So we we've seen this in Kisumu as well, that where the footbridges have been built, such as at the Mega City Mall, they're not used very well. So we need to make sure that we provide safe at-grade crossings instead. And this is what that can look like. In Kisumu, some of these ramped crossings have been built, but they're staggered. So they're not, you know, you can cross over half of the street, but then it doesn't continue on the other side of the median. So we need to make sure that all of these tabletops are continuous and they provide good access. This is an example of one that was recently built in Nairobi on Gong Road, and it provides much better access. It slows down the vehicles and provides a clear space for people to cross. Okay, and then for the intersection retrofits, this is what we're talking about. This is an example from Addis Ababa in Ethiopia, where the city has tightened the size of the intersection down so that you still have the three through lanes that are there continue, but you don't provide all that extra space that was just making it very unsafe for people to cross. And you can do this initially as a tactical intervention, like what you can see here in the photo. And then eventually what Addis did at this junction is they made it permanent. So they actually built out the curbs once they had the budget to fill in that, you know, the new outline that's there. So that's how we can retrofit these intersections to make sure that they're safe for all users. And then the last part is the school zone improvements. So this would involve several components within a 200 meter radius of each school. So having footpaths, raised crossings, at least one crossing outside the school and probably another one at the nearest junction. And then having traffic calming to ensure and to actually enforce a speed limit of 30 kilometers per hour. And there needs to be good signage to go along with it so that people are aware that they're entering a school zone. And the other thing I'd point out here, you can see on the map that a lot of the schools are concentrated on some of the busiest corridors like Kenyatta Highway, also Nairobi Road. And so these are the same corridors that are seeing a lot of pedestrian fatalities and other types of crashes. So it's that further reinforces the need for these safety retrofits along the Kenha corridors. Okay. And then the Greenway could offer an alternative. You know, those of you who are in Kisumu, you know that Obote Road is a pretty hectic corridor for cycling right now, because it has, you know, has a lot of go downs. There are a lot of freight vehicles moving up and down. And so this greenway along the lakefront could provide a parallel corridor to Obote Road that would allow cyclists and pedestrians to move toward the city center much more easily. So that's the greenway proposal. And the connections to the street network can be improved over time, you know, where we don't have existing streets. So then to facilitate these NMT improvements, we need to make sure that we manage vending a lot better. Vending can be compatible with walkways and cycle access, but provided that it has designated space. And that's what's missing on a lot of the streets today. And so vendors end up taking a lot of the pedestrian space, but if it's well organized, it can be compatible with the other street uses. And then stormwater is also critical to having better walking and cycling access, but better street access overall in the city. And so the idea here is to make sure that all of the 100 kilometers of NMT facilities have good drains, but then to develop 20 kilometers of additional stormwater drains so that we really address the water logging that's happening. And you know, we've seen during the past few months that there have been serious flooding issues in the county. So this is something that we need to address to shore up the resilience in the city. Okay, so those are the NMT and the related infrastructure improvements. And then we can also think about how to improve NMT access through bike share. And this is something that the city's been interested in developing. You know, bike share can help improve last mile access to public transport, but it can also serve short trips, especially in the city center that people are making during the day. And so from an initial mapping of the optimal station locations, we'd have a network of around 400 cycles that would probably provide a decent first phase network for the city, and it could be expanded over time. So that's a component of the mobility plan. And the cycle needs to be designed well. It needs to be a robust design with a step through frame, with good components and measures to protect against theft and vandalism. And it needs to have protected components, so protected brake cables and things like that. So that's bike share. And then getting to public transport, this is really one of the major initiatives in the mobility plan. We have a lot of challenges in the existing public transport system. And as Engineer Jerry mentioned, COVID-19 has really brought that out, that if we want to have a mobility system that provides access and also protects public health, we need to look at some serious changes in the way that we operate the public transport in the city. There are several components to it. One is on the operations. So really looking at transforming the industry and achieving operational improvements and better business models so that we can provide good service. And unless we really change the underlying model, we won't be able to change the outcomes like road safety and convenience for passengers. Then at the same time, we also need to look at the vehicle fleet, how we can upgrade the fleet to make sure that the entire fleet is roadworthy, that it provides universal access, and that the fleet is keeping up with the growth in population and travel demand in the city. And then we need to pair that with the physical infrastructure on the streets. So we need to have better bus shelters and we need to build terminals. We only have the bus park in the city center, but that can be addressed. And looking at network expansion so that the public transport isn't just sticking to the streets where it's currently operating, but it grows into new areas of the city to provide better coverage. And then finally, we should look at creating dedicated road space in the form of BRT in the longer term. So let's get into what these mean. First of all, with the public transport reform, there are several outcomes that we'd want to achieve at the end of the day. So services operated, instead of the more atomistic arrangement that we have today, we need to move toward having more consolidated operating entities. So strengthening the SACO structures that we have today, or turning them into corporations that can run the public transport services, and having salaried staff so that we can move away from the current target system, because that's really at the root of a lot of the challenges that we have. And unless we change the way that staff are compensated, we're not going to be able to achieve much in the way of road safety improvements. Another key element is finding ways to ensure that the existing public transport industry staff can participate in these new operating units, right? So this involves some capacity building, allowing staff to participate in the new structures. Fare collection through electronic means, having independent revenue management. This has come out during COVID-19, and NTSA has already started working on developing, empaneling companies that can provide cashless fare payment. So we need to see how to accelerate those efforts and move toward electronic fare collection. And then finally, in the longer term, moving toward a business model with per kilometer payments. And this is the idea of, again, changing the incentives so that vehicles are not rushing to pick up every passenger, but are instead operating according to schedules, and they get compensated for the service they do, but with the right incentives for service quality, for safety, instead of solely being incentivized by the number of people who are carried on each trip. So those are some of the outcomes that we'd want to achieve. And this will take a methodical process. We need to gather proper data to understand where people are traveling, like where the vehicles are going, how many vehicles are operating on each route, so that the city and county can make an informed decision about how to structure the operating arrangements. There would be some process, there's a big difference between having a modern bus operating company and the current operating system that we have. So there's some capacity building that could go into that. And then the negotiation and company formation process. And there would need to be discussion about how the shareholding will be handled in order to form these modern operating units. And there's a really important role for the government in this whole process. So I really want to stress that, it has to be a partnership. So it's not just a matter of putting unfunded mandates on the public transport industry. We really need to step up and say, how can government be an active manager of the public transport system to help ensure that service quality standards are met? So working with operators to discuss the advantages of these consolidated operating units, and then helping to actually form the new companies, these strengthened SACO structures to run the services. And then there could be a role in helping to set up some of these training courses for the public transport workforce. So those are some of the ingredients that can help, help from the operational side. And then we need to pair that with looking at, better vehicle models. How can we move toward vehicles that are actually designed for urban service, so they're more accessible to all users. They have wider doors, wider aisles, better circulation space, and also moving toward lower emissions, because we have some really old vehicles in the city that really don't meet any emissions standard, and that needs to be fixed. Okay, and then paired with that, we need to have the better infrastructure on the streets. So having proper bus shelters to give people protection from sun and rain. We identified about 167 locations based on the existing boarding and lighting locations that we mapped out, but also some new locations in areas that currently don't have public transport service. And then the county is currently developing these peripheral terminals for the inner city services. And so it's important to look at how we're developing those, making sure that those terminals meet these same standards, that they have good shelters, they have universal access, they have adequate lighting for all the users. And so those elements can be planned together. And then looking at the public transport network expansion. So as we explained earlier today, there are a lot of areas in Kisumu that really don't have good public transport access. And if we think that most people should be able to walk with, not more than 5 or 8 minutes to get to a bus stop, we're not very close to achieving that right now. I have a lot of areas of the city that are well outside the coverage area of public transport. So we need to look at how to expand the network. And in some cases, what you can see here in the diagram, the red lines show where we can add service on existing streets, but there are also corridors where we need to have new service on new streets where we don't have a paved corridor currently. So we need to develop a paved street with good footpaths and bus shelters that could actually carry public transport vehicles moving into these areas. And that way we'd bring a lot more people into walking distance of public transport, and they wouldn't be as dependent on costly boda-boda services anymore. So that's the network expansion. And then finally, I would touch on BRT. we saw that the volumes on Kenyatta Highway are actually quite high, and public transport is carrying the majority of the users. And so there's really no reason to not allocate some road space to public transport, right? So that we can speed up the vehicles and ensure that as we, you know, if the use of private vehicles increases, we can try to arrest that trend by providing more reliable public transport. And BRT is really a system, you know, it's more than just creating the bus lanes. It involves having level boarding, having the stations, having higher capacity buses, and all these elements can fit together to provide high quality service. And this is what it could look like on Kenyatta Highway, you know, really transforming that corridor from, you know, the current design where it's currently designed more like a rural highway, but we can redesign it as an urban street that really prioritizes public transport instead of the current design where we don't even have bus shelters, right? So let's really, you know, transform the way that we design these spaces so that they're prioritizing more sustainable modes. Okay, great. So that's public transport. And then we come to the Boda Boda and tuk-tuk taxi sector. So there are a number of modes in the city, you know, different vehicles, the motorcycles, tuk-tuks, and even some car taxis that are all providing these, you know, private point-to-point services. And there's a lot of work to be done in improving the safety and also making sure that these vehicles have a lower impact on the environment. So things like having electronic meters, making sure that helmet use is more widespread, and then developing a real licensing system for the vehicles and drivers. And this could be facilitated by the, you know, technology providers like Safe Boda and Uber Boda, you know, so that there you can actually give feedback to drivers where they're making abrupt movements or they're driving, you know, faster than what's safe for the particular street. So this is something that's happening in you know in other cities in the region like Kigali, and we can bring this to Kisumu as well. And then looking at the electrification and finally, you know, making sure that we have designated parking areas. So instead of having you know Boda's parking at street corners where they block the walkway, the crosswalks, you know, having dedicated, you know, taking one parking spot on each block that we turn into a defined Boda Boda parking spot, so that we, you know, we rationalize where the Bodas are staging and avoid conflicts with the NMT users. So those are things that we can do for Boda Bodas. And then let's talk about parking. So parking management, you know, while we're trying to improve a lot of services, we also need to look at the, you know, at the sticks in addition to the carrots, right? And make sure that we're providing, you know, we're managing the use of private vehicles actively, and then over time we're providing disincentives for, you know, for greater and greater use. So, you know, oftentimes we think that parking is an obligation of government. You know, it's not. Like, parking's really a private matter. And, you know, asking government to give you a parking space would be as crazy as this guy here who's saying that he, you know, he just bought an air conditioner and he, you know, he wants a government to build him a house where he can install the air conditioner. You know, it's, you know, if you buy the car, it's really your responsibility to come up with a place to park it. And so that's the principle that we need to bring into the way that we manage the parking spaces. Because if we keep increasing, you know, if we build some parking, you know, more vehicles will be attracted. Then they say, okay, where are we going to park? So then you need to build more parking. Maybe we say we need to build a multi-story structure. Okay, then even more people come to the CBD. So, you know, how are we going to escape this cycle, right? There's no end to it. And it, you know, it's just like trying to address traffic congestion by building wider roads. You know, it doesn't work in the long term. So we have to escape that vicious cycle. We can do that by having demand-based parking fees. They should be calibrated to the demand in local areas. So rather than just having a uniform parking fee across the whole city, you know, actually calibrating the fee to the demand levels in different areas. And then really stepping up the enforcement so that we you know, we keep track of how many cars the enforcement personnel are checking, you know, making sure that there isn't a lot of leakage. And this needs to be paired with proper customer information. So if we have variable parking charges across the city, that should be very transparent to people. So it's not a mystery, you know, why you're being charged more in a certain part of the city. Okay. So that's parking. And then the next part is transit-oriented development. So as we make all these investments in public transport, you know, we're renovating the vehicle fleet, we're upgrading the operational standards, you know, we need to make sure that we respond to that in the land use patterns, okay? Because currently in Kisumu, if you look at the zoning maps, they don't necessarily reflect the level of public transport access in the city. And so something that we can do is to create a TOD zoning overlay that incorporates several aspects, right? So I've put a few of them here. One is small block sizes, so making sure that we develop a more interconnected pedestrian network. And so this means every time that we, you know, if there's a large plot that goes to redevelopment, we can ensure that there is a new pedestrian cut through through the middle of that block. Okay, so that people have easier access to the adjacent bus stops, to shops that are on the main road, and so on. We also need to make sure that we allow the highest plot ratios along public transport corridors, okay? Because I think in the current zoning, we have some, you know, very low density residential areas that are zoned that way right next to our busiest public transport corridors. And because those areas have the best access, we need to make sure that the land use can respond to that access. And as part of that, there should be explicit incentives for affordable housing. So you may not just give a density bonus to anyone along the public transport corridor. You know, it could be in for people who are willing to build smaller units. So say if you're willing to build flats that are less than 40 square meters, then you would be allowed to build at a higher plot ratio. So we can think about how to build those incentives in and ensure that we have more, you know, compact and mixed use development along the key public transport corridors. And we start to, you know, move away from the compound walls and have more active edges, you know, like this example here. And then having explicit building control rules that move us away from, you know, the compound walls toward having more visually active facades, having permeability for pedestrians. So, you know, basically having more entrances along the street. So these are all the elements that can come into both the zoning regulations and then also the building rules. And these can help ensure that the land use is also conducive toward achieving these sustainable mobility goals that are outlined in the plan. Okay. And then the last part I'll talk about is communications and outreach, because it's really important that we start communicating these changes that are happening. And things like car-free days can really make an impact, both for practitioners and also for regular citizens to really re-envision how the street space can be used. You know, that it doesn't have to just be allocated to cars, but we can have much more creative uses of our street space. And, you know, so cities like Kigali, you can see in the lower photo here, Mexico City, in our region also Addis Ababa has started car-free days. You know, this is something that can really give people a chance, especially people who don't have access to open space on a regular basis, to use their streets in a new way. Having good marketing and outreach for ongoing projects, you know, having sustainable commuting days so maybe one day per month, all county staff and city staff can travel by matatu or bicycle or foot, you know, to their offices. And, you know, and so that way we can really, you know, we can show by doing how this transformation can happen. And then I think the final component of this is making sure that plans for ongoing projects are released. You know, people have easy access to information on what's happening in the city and they can give their input. Great. So I hope that gives you an idea of the kinds of measures that are in the plan. And now I'll hand it over to my colleague Itao to talk about the implementation process and the budget for doing this.
Okay, then thank you, Chris. I'll take you through the next part of the goals which are highlighted in this mobility plan, and that is the implementation and investment plan. One thing that is worth noting is that for us to achieve all the goals which are highlighted in this plan is there will be need for continuous projects in the implementation of the projects. Also, there's need to have a strong political will and support from the government. Also, there is also a need to have an adequate allocation of budget. And one of the ways in which we can be able to achieve the goals which are highlighted in this plan is by having demonstration projects. For example, in the streets which have got high volumes of pedestrians and service access to public transport, they can be improved and to show how the benefits that can be achieved by having the complete streets. Then for this need to have a capacity building, and these capacity building programs can be organized by the key stakeholders, how you can have the city county, is the road agencies, which is KERA, KENHA, KURA, and also the consultants. Then to help reach out to people, there's need to share the knowledge on sustainable mobility and sustainable transport. And some of the topics on which the staff can be trained on is we have the street design manual for urban areas in Kenya. This is a manual which is being developed by the Ministry of Transport, and it gives guidance on how to design and implement complete streets. Also, there's need to have community participation techniques on project planning and implementation, and this can be done by the year 2021. Then there's also there's need to have reforms in public transport. The public transport reforms by modernizing the existing operations in our public transport. Also, the staff need to be trained on the bus rapid transit, that is the BRT, and also on the bike share. Then there's need to have coordination between the national level and the local and the county level, and some of the roles which are played by the institution. For example, the county government, this is the one which should provide political leadership and general oversight of all the projects which are being implemented in the city. The county should also ensure there is adequate allocation for budget for the NMT, and also implementation of public transport and improvements in the public transport. Then the role of the city of Kisumu, the city can be involved in the implementation of the NMT facilities, also the maintenance of existing NMTs which have been provided. The city should also manage on-street parking, vending, manage the existing public transport, the stormwater drains, and also make improvements on the streets which do not have adequate streetlights. Then the other institution is the Ministry of Transport, Infrastructure, Housing and Urban Development, and the role which is being played is on the national level. It should formulate the transport policies and land use policies, which will guide the projects which are being implemented in the city. It can also secure the finance for transport facilities, as well as the operational subsidies when we have the improved public transport operations. Then for the road agencies, we have KENHA. KENHA is mandated with implementation, designing and implementation of the national roads, as well as it needs to make improvements on the walking and cycling facilities, and also the public transport facilities which traverses the KENHA corridors. As you know, in Kisumu, we have major road corridors which are served by KENHA and be done by KENHA. So when these agencies designing the roads, there's need to implement the high quality walking facilities and also provision of the BRT in the future. Also, there's need to ensure that there's adequate allocation of budget when these road agencies are implementing their projects. They need to have adequate budget for NMT and public transport. Then there's the Kenya Urban Roads Agency, KURA, which is in charge of the urban roads. And the responsibility should be to design and implement the high quality walking and public transport facilities within the urban areas. And it should also ensure that the budget which is allocated, there is adequate provisions for NMT. It should not only provide for the carriage for vehicles, but also make provisions for the non-motorized transport and public transport. Then issues to do with safety, we have the National Transport and Safety Authority, NTSA, which should enforce the traffic rules. It should also educate the street users and identify the black spots, as you saw in the map. We've got so most of the accidents occur along our major highways, and NTSA is in charge of making sure that we reduce the fatalities. Also, there should be coordination with the Kenya police, who are in charge of controlling and managing the traffic operations on our highways and also on the roads which are within the urban areas. Then for the Kenya Ports Authority, we have the Greenway, the proposed waterfront project, and Kenya Ports Authority should manage the water transport in the along Lake Victoria. Then looking at the investment plan, this has been categorized into three phases. We have the short term, which is covering 2021 to 2022. Then there is the medium term, 2023 to 2025, and the long term, which is going from 2026 to 2030. And these gives a summary of the capital cost of investments on the projects which are to be improved and the projects which are highlighted in the mobility plan. For the short term, these are the quick wins. These are the quick win projects, so which do not have to wait for quite a long time. These are the projects which need immediate attention. There's need to make improvements on the school zones. The plan has identified 40 zones. And you saw that the school zones are located on the major highways, and that's where most accidents are occurring. So the capital cost of making improvements on the school zones got to about $167.4 million. That is in the long run. Then there is a need to make to retrofit the Kenha corridors by providing safe crossings along a stretch of 28 kilometers, and this will go to about 52.5. Then there is also retrofitting and improving the intersection design. Most of the intersections have got a very wide turning radius, and there's a lot of conflict. And you also find that most accidents occur at these intersections. So then the other issue is improvements on the pedestrian facilities. We can start, this is going to be a continuous process, but in the short term we can do 20 kilometers and 30 kilometers in the medium and 50 kilometers. So by 2030, we'll have achieved about 100 kilometers of nice pedestrian facilities. Also, there is a need to make improvements on the cycle tracks in the short term. By 2022, we can have 15 kilometers of nice cycle tracks and 9 in the medium term and in the long term. So by 2030, we'll have made improvements about a stretch covering that 1 kilometer, is at about 9 million. Then there is need to make improvements on the waterfront as well as the bicycle parking. So that in the city, there are some areas which have made provision for the bicycle parking racks, but there's need to make more investments in which can be done in the medium term. Then there is a need to have an annual maintenance, which is going to be about 10% of the capital cost, and that would come to about 530 million. Then implementation of the bike share, as Chris said, the bike share can help in easing the congestion in the town, in the city, and investments in having 400 cycles go to about 240 million. And this can be done in the medium term. Then there is the investment plan on public transport. There's need to have continuous public transport studies, that is to determine the demand, the existing demand in the public transport. This can be done in the short term by about 2022, which go to about 20 million. Then for the industry transition and negotiation with the bus operators, this is something which should be ongoing in the short and medium term. Also, we need to train our drivers on better driving, which should be a continuous process all the way to 2030. Then there's need, we saw that most of the bus stops do not have the bus shelters. So there's need to make improvements on these facilities, which is going to be a continuous process in the short, medium, and long term. Then for the improvements in the public transport, the target is a medium and long term, or you can replace the existing public transport fleet by replacing with the modernized vehicles which are suited for the urban transport. Also, there's need to have to make improvements and provide new streets which are going to serve public transport. As you saw, areas such as East Manyata, Edombuga are not served by public transport. And there's need to enhance that connectivity, and that can be done in the medium term. Then the design and design of the BRT is a medium-term goal. And construction of the first phase of the BRT can occur in 2026 to 2030, right, for the first 5 kilometers of the BRT. Then there is also another investment that can be done is on the street lights. These are the street elements, the street lights, the border borders, and stormwater. We saw that most of the streets are not covered by street lights. This is going to be a continuous process. So by the year 2030, we will have covered 100 kilometers, well covered with street lights at a cost of about 400 million. And then for the improvements on the border behavior and safety, this should be a continuous process from the short term up to the year 2030. Then there's also a need to introduce enhanced IT parking systems. Then for the stormwater drains, the stormwater drain by 2030, we can have additional 20 kilometers of drains. And the cost of the drainage incur very huge cost, as in your area. Kisumu is prone to flooding in some of the areas. And so there's need to make a huge investment in the plant to cover for these stormwater drain. Then the other investment plan is on communication, and there's need for capacity building. Can be monthly car-free days. For example, every month we can have a car-free day, and this would cost about 30 million. Then there is a need to have the annual road safety campaign, engage the public engagement workshops to train the public on sustainable mobility and also on this plan. Then there's need to offer trainings on street design, public transport, and also transit-oriented development. Then there will be need to develop a university curriculum on sustainable mobility. So there's need to partner with the technical institution and universities and train students on sustainable mobility. Then also can be study visits for the senior officials and decision makers they can go out and experience other cities and see how sustainable mobility is being achieved. Then there is need to establish the Kisumu Sustainable Mobility Steering Committee, and this is going to be a continuous process, and as well as having an annual mobility indicator tracking, which is going to be a continuous process. Based on that, so the choice is ours as key decision makers. Are we going to continue building our cities for cars? As you can see, if you build wider roads, you'll just have an increase in the traffic jams. There will be increase in pollution. The number of deaths are going to increase if you continue focusing on a design for cars. A better approach should be to make, which is highlighted in the plan, is to have a future where the cities are designed for people, where we can add transit, add density, cut down on the parking, and we're going to have a better quality of life. Yeah, thank you all.
Thank you very much, ITDP. We appreciate the very, very comprehensive presentation on what you have been doing since 2016 with Kisumu County. I'm sure the participants who have already responded have asked a number of questions, but would like to make a suggestion. It's now 11:37. If we could just take a short commercial break to give ITDP time to catch their breath as you formulate your questions, then we reconvene at around 10 minutes to midday, and then we can address a few of the concerns that participants are raising. If that's agreeable, I'd like to suggest that we do that and then come back with as many remarks, recommendations, questions, so that we can wrap up this thing very well. Thank you again, ITDP, for the very professional job. Thank you, Kisumu County, for partnering very well on this study. So let's take a break and then we reconvene shortly. Thank you.
Okay.
I'd like to welcome us back. I hope you've had a good break, taken your cup of tea, taken your coffee. And again, to reiterate that from UN Habitat, we are very proud to be associated with ITDP. They have done a great job, not only in Kisumu, but trying to help the complicated city of Nairobi with public transport planning, NMT improvements. And for me to see something on Gong Road, just a traffic calming measure that allows pedestrians to cross, as opposed to those very expensive and unutilized footbridges, that's a very good indication that you're on the right track. I have seen quite a number of reactions. Thank you, participants, for your observations. I'm sure ITDP will take them up as they prepare to complete this plan and to present it to the authorities in Kisumu. I think I'll start by asking ITDP to quickly respond on one or two that have been shared. One is the role of the Kenya Roads Board. I think on that table you did not include the Kenya Roads Board. Kindly let us know what their role would be. Proposals on e-mobility. I think I did hear Chris present on e-mobility for the border borders, but perhaps you want to say a bit more about e-mobility. I'm aware that the European Commission is no longer going to fund Euro 4s and wants to change from the fossil fuels to better vehicles, the electric vehicles, even for the BRT buses. So you may want to comment on e-mobility and perhaps expand on that. There is a question that you did not mention something on desire lines, if you could pick that up. Those are the ones that I picked. Others were just observations, the need to harmonize various interventions by the road agencies, by the county government, the Kenya Building Code, and how that should be addressed. But you may want to begin with the ones that I've highlighted. Participants, please feel free to raise other issues so that ITDP can respond, and indeed so that we can interact with Kisumu County, because they're also here. My old colleague, Robert Shoda, good to see you.
Hi, Arab.
Hi, good to see you on board.
Good to see you. Yeah, good to see you.
Okay, if you could mute your mic, mute your video, it's a bit disruptive, we'll appreciate. ITDP, over to you. Kindly provide us with some feedback.
Thanks, Rehab. Maybe I can comment on Kenya Roads Board. I know Kenya Roads Board deals with the fuel levy fund, and they allocate funds to counties and to national government, Kenha, Kura. And most of this funding is going towards the construction of the roads, mainly to serve the cars. Perhaps what we can, what I would hope is that more of the fuel levy fund can go towards the construction of NMT to serve the majority, the larger population who are walking, who are cycling and using the public transport. And also when it comes to improve the public transport facilities, the passenger shelters at the bus stops, the BRT, the role of the KRB will come in very much, because there'll be need for funding for the pavements for the dedicated lanes for the buses and the good NMT that we are talking about here. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I can try to take up a couple of the other questions. So for e-mobility, yeah, thanks for that comment. And we've been discussing with partners about including a bit more detail on the e-mobility rollout. For the Boda Boda sector, there's certainly a lot of opportunity because there are a number of ongoing initiatives throughout East Africa that are looking at different models for electrifying the bodas. And so that's something that you can probably roll out pretty quickly. And then for e-buses, the main challenge right now is that e-bus technology is still maturing. And so e-buses don't necessarily have the same range on a single charge that regular diesel buses would. And so they have to be deployed carefully. You know, for instance, on some of the shorter routes, they can make sense. And so we can certainly look at that as part of the overall, you know, scheme of public transport improvements. And so what probably needs to happen is in the short term, we need to ensure that all buses, if we're still getting conventional fuel buses, they need to meet a much better pollution spec. You know, so now that we have low sulfur fuel in Kenya, we can have at least Euro 4 buses in the city. But you know, we can do better, but it's also a matter of cost. And then also look at, you know, obtaining finance to electrify the fleet over time, because it certainly makes sense from a number of perspectives. But we, you know, given that it's right now electric vehicles do involve a much higher capital cost, so we have to weigh that against the other requirements of, you know, just being able to get more vehicles on the road in Kisumu as one of the goals, in addition to, you know, making sure that each electric vehicle is cleaner. Because, you know, with the public transport, you know, a lot of the emission savings come from shifting trips from other more polluting modes to public transport. So in addition to, you know, reducing the pollution that's created by each public transport trip. So, you know, we need to focus on that, you know, that means of emissions reduction as well.
Something on desire lines.
Oh yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is a good point. So desire lines. We a lot of times we design the pedestrian crossings without considering the desire lines, and that when I was talking about the staggered tabletops that are there on many of the recently constructed highway corridors, that's an example where, you know, we're not paying attention to the desire lines, and so the crossings don't necessarily, or the, you know, the traffic calmed raised tables don't necessarily correspond to where people want to cross. So we need to make sure that when we're designing crossings, they're in line with the natural you know, patterns that people are making. And when we're designing intersections, we should make sure not to offset the crosswalk so much. They should be basically in line with the direction that pedestrians and cyclists are moving. And that will help ensure that people actually use these crossings. So as part of the discussion around the Kenyatta Highway design, we had worked with the county and Kenha to identify you know, a set of bus stops and also crossing locations that reflect the existing desire lines. And that's an example of the kind of analysis that needs to happen on all of the corridors to make sure that we're developing high quality, you know, traffic calmed or signalized crossings where people want to cross.
Thank you. Engineer Jerry, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, as much as possible, the designs that we come up with, or the designs that either the county government or the Kenha and Kura, as Chris mentioned, they need to be aligned to what the current situation, to serving the current situation, like maybe like let's say where the most people catch the public transport. We should try as much as possible to bring to have the bus stop as close as possible to that location, because there is a reason why people will cross at a particular place or they will prefer to take their buses at a particular place. So it's good to make it the infrastructure more functional, more usable. Then it's very important to make sure that we are aligned to the current demands on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to remind the participants that you can raise your hand. There's a hand at the participants list if you want to speak. And as you prepare to do that, I just wanted to invite, I think, Engineer Sule from Kisumu County. We've seen a very good plan, very good, excellent in terms of the data collection, the recommendations, the vision. What chances do we have as Kenyans to see Kisumu become the trendsetter for the other cities? You've already started on a good note, but we want our hope reactivated today that this plan will not go to the shelves. Would you care to just help us with a comment on that as a Kenyan? I'm curious to know, will this be another dusty book on the shelves, or will it see the light of day? The rest of us, you can raise your hands so that we are a bit orderly in our responses. Thank you.
Thank you, Rahab. It is a tough question for me, but it could have been responded to by the good Professor Larry, who is my chair, and he's a member of the Kisumu City, engineer by profession. But then just to illustrate and to reaffirm that this document is not going to waste in our shelves. Already we picked out a few areas that we need to implement as a quick win. And that is the area that Engineer Njeri has been sharing, which we refer to as the triangle. On the CBD, we already started implementing NMT. And in our current development plan, we're looking at four roads on which we are going to roll out on an NMT. Basically, again, in our plan which we are finalizing, that is the local physical detail plan, and land use and physical plan, we already again put all those recommendations in it, and we're looking at rolling out not only in the CBD, but the entire city. Moving forward, we are looking at any development on roads that are going to be tarmacked. Then we must consider an NMT aspect on it, and this will be the integration. We're also working with the UN Habitat and UNEP to ensure that we have a cleaner environment, and that is having electrification of our motorbikes, of our tuk-tuk, and most of the cars. And we're also looking at when we have the BRT as envisaged, though a bit earlier than projected by ITDP, we also look at using the same mode of fueling so that we have cleaner energy. So that, I believe, reaffirms that Kisumu is going to implement this plan once it has been approved by the assembly.
Thank you, Engineer. Well appreciated.
Sorry, Madam Harab.
Yes.
I want to say that there are a few people that we must acknowledge that worked with us to probably develop this plan. And one of them is Professor George Mark, who I think is present in this forum. We have Dr. Emmanuel Mideme and planner Evelyn Otieno. We had our former town clerk, Madam Olale, Belinda Nyakinya. We had John Sande Nyamita, late engineer Werunga. And we started this journey together with the Scots, and it's good that we are getting to this point together. The stakeholders were engaged well. We engaged with the Boda Boda, that is the Bice, the Ngware, that is the bicycle rider. We engaged with the Piki Piki, now called Boda Boda. We engaged with Tuk Tuk, the matatu sector intensively. And then all of them, I must appreciate for their contribution. these are the people who made us get to where we are because of their support, their cooperation. And Engineer Njeri, for having picked up, you see, we started in 2016, but it's now that we are getting to finalize on the document. So at least there was a lot of work that was put together with Engineer Njeri and the entire team and Scott and Chris. That is the remark that I wanted to make.
Thank you, Engineer. I'd like to give the space to Professor Leonard Mulongo. Please be brief and to the point so that you can give many more people an opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you, presenters and the organizers. I just want to appreciate what is going on. It is on the right track. Now, as we continue looking at this particular aspect, what I want to emphasize here is, let us look at the trend in terms of how development is taking a place in Kisumu. Let us also appreciate the structuring elements, like the lake is somewhere, and then towards the north, there is also Riat Hills and so on. So as much as we are talking of planning for these particular facilities, let us look at these particular structuring elements in terms of how they are going to impact on the development of these particular utilities. The other aspect that you need to appreciate is that Kisumu will not remain in isolation. There are these trends whereby people tend to be moving also towards Ahero and so on. And soon you'll find that the town might extend up to that particular area. So anything that we have in mind, just the way I was saying, let us appreciate how these desire lines will be formed based on where the traffic is emanating from, the origin destination patterns, insofar as development is concerned. So that out of that, then we can now say that within the central business district, this is what we anticipate. And then within the hinterland, we need to see how we are going to again plan for these particular utilities. Once that is done, then you will find that all these particular aspects that we have mentioned can easily be fully integrated. Otherwise, I appreciate quite a lot in terms of what Kisumu is doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I think those comments are well received. The team did refer to integrated transport planning, TODs, and that should help take care of your concerns. I'll give the space to Judith Oginga, Steve Okuku, Steve Gome, in that order. Kindly be brief and to the point, and you're very welcome.
Yes, thank you, Rahab. And I mean, I'm personally very excited about this plan. I think ITDP and the county government of Kisumu did a really good job. And just to support what Steven said, actually, we as the stakeholders will not allow the county government of Kisumu to let this plan go to the shelves. We will put pressure on the county government. And I have to say this about Kisumu. Having worked with a number of counties in Kenya, I think this is one of the counties where the county officials have shown immense commitment to advancing the county, and we are really proud, of course, as UN Habitat for the support and the commitment that the county has shown. This is a plan which we can see clearly that the county has ownership of, and I believe every stakeholder here is actually rooting for the county to win on this one. So we will not allow this plan to go to any shelf. In terms of electrification, I think I saw some comments there, and this is just to say again that we will push for this. We think that Kisumu County presents a very good case for this, and we are hoping to push forward on this agenda in the county. Thank you.
Steve Okuku, please.
Yes, so good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I'd like to appreciate what the county government of Kisumu is doing in making sure that we have a very sustainable transport system. So just a quick introduction on who I'm presenting here today. So I'm Steve Okuku. I work with WETU and CMS Stifton. And the role that we do is test solutions electric solutions and having necessary data to justify scale up of electric mobility solutions. So we are looking to establish a blueprint for local e-mobility charging stations and create a network of skilled e-mobility technicians in rural Kenya, Siaya, Migori, and Homa Bay counties specifically. And I heard one of the, someone mentioned something to do with electric mobility, and it got me excited because we already have a number of initiatives in East Africa. So my question would be to the county government of Kisumu. Yes, so you've heard that there are initiatives in Africa to introduce e-mobility. So what's the county currently up to in order to accelerate and maybe adopt these initiatives in the county?
Okay, that's a question to the county. Can we wait until we have Steve Gome make his response kindly? And Steve Gome, tell us who you are representing. It's good to know who we are speaking to. Thank you.
Thanks very much, everyone. My name is Steve Gome. I'm the Director of Urban Development in Kisumu County. And maybe we'll have another chance to do some of the questions once all the participants have raised some questions. But I wanted to make a comment on the scheduling or in terms of programming of the BRT proposal. We are really quite under instruction that this is something that the governor is quite keen on to see happening before the next general elections. And given that we are having the AfriCities being hosted in Kisumu next year, I think it will be good and in good earnest if we could, as stakeholders and as the technical people who have worked in this field, we'll probably bring this forward as a short-term strategy and not a medium term, so that we have the designs and tender documentation probably moving forward from this year, December, so that within a year we can actually say we have a project that we can implement. Because already there's goodwill. We, through the Kenya Cities Forum, have pushed the national government to do some allocation to the cities, the five cities of Kenya. And I think in this year's budget, there's already 5% that is allocated to urban issues, especially the cities that we already have in Kenya of Kisumu, Nairobi, Nakuru, Eldoret, and Mombasa. So in issues of financing, we'd probably want to take that opportunity because the money is going to be there in every subsequent budget. And in any case, we still also have Kenya Urban Support Program, which we can really channel into this to see this as a reality within the next 2 years. So as stakeholders and as our support in the urban mobility plan, we ask that we probably look at this as a very urgent thing so that we can actually have BRT implemented, or at least its first phase implemented within the next 3 years in Kisumu. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. That's very encouraging. And I can assure you, ITDP, UN Habitat, are rearing to go with you on that. And we'll be discussing further details. There was a clarification on e-mobility from Steve Okuku, but I'd like to invite another hand for their intervention. Has he resigned? I don't see the hand anymore, so I think the person has, Kevin seems to have left. So kindly comment on the e-mobility Kisumu County. What are the plans so that you can link well with Steve Okuku?
Thank you. I want to give it to Madam Judith to respond to that.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. So as we can see in the ITDP plan, actually e-mobility has been clearly outlined as one of the strategies that will be implemented in the plan. And there is a 10-year implementation plan, which includes, of course, all the solutions, NMT, public transport, and then there is also integration of electric mobility. Two things that would be interesting for We2 Mobility, who asked the question is, In the period of 2021 to 2022, we have a study, feasibility study for electrification of public transport in Kisumu. And then in the period between 2023 to 2030, we have a plan whereby we are set to electrify 50% of the boda bodas and tuk-tuks and also electrify the bus fleet by 2030. So clearly the plan, the Kisumu plan already integrates e-mobility very well. And there is a place for all players who are working within the e-mobility sphere to plug into. We are also already in touch with WeToo Mobility actually to see possibilities of expanding your activity in Western Kenya into Kisumu. So this is definitely a good time to raise such a question, and this has been addressed in the plan.
Thank you, Judith. I welcome Walter Alando to kindly make his intervention.
Thank you very much. This is Alando. I work for Maseno University, School of Planning and Architecture. Now, two things that I would like to observe at this point. One is if you look at the circulation of traffic, but particularly public transport in Kisumu, you realize that it's a bit linear and not making a loop in the sense that vehicles originate from particular points within the estates and they go to the city center and use the same routes to get back to where they came from, to the estates. And that in a way limits them from serving a number of other areas that were pointed out, areas like Obunga and Manyata East that the presenters pointed out already. I don't know what your plans are with regards to rerouting public transport within the city. That's one. Two is with regard to an earlier proposal that comes up in the Kisumu ISUD. And there are proposals there to decentralize what we currently call the bus park to areas in Nyamasaria, you have Otonglo, and you have Mamboleo. Now, these I believe will serve vehicles that, I mean, these bus stops will, bus parks will serve inter-county transport. And the question is, how does one make a connection if you stop, for example, at Nyamasaria and you want to go to the airport, you're from Mahero side. How do you make that transition? I think that would be something important to address in this plan. Plus, of course, the Kenya Vision 2030 identifies Kisumu as one of the flagship cities. And together with that, there's a proposal to have a tram system for the city. And I didn't hear something on this. I'm just curious to hear something in this line. Thank you.
Thank you. Chris, do you want to take that?
Sure, yeah. So yeah, I agree that there are some limitations in the public transport network. And that's something that we need to look into in more detail. And what I would propose to the county is that we work on a more detailed public transport service plan, because I think that's really what's necessary to understand the origins and destinations of the trips that people are making and where they're transferring, especially for all the journeys that take more than one matatu or tuk-tuk. And based on that, we could help to optimize the public transport route network and potentially identify if there are cases where a single route could help carry people directly to where they're trying to go so that they don't have to continue to transfer through the city center. Then we question of the tram system. I mean, the challenge is usually that trams or light rail systems are 4 to 5 times, you know, from a feeder line to the tram line. So I think at least for starters, and you know, given that there's a finite budget available to try to achieve these public transport improvements in the city, it would make sense to start with a bus-based system. And the other advantage is that this would also, allow us to empower the existing industry, and not just instead of having to to buy foreign equipment and technology and even import, have foreign workforce come in. we can rely more on the local skills and, you know, and workforce that's already there in Kisumu to run an enhanced public transport system. So that was the thinking, I think, you know, behind the county's desire to move forward with the BRT and, you know, and really rely on the bus-based transport as part of the public transport plan.
Okay, I'm reading the chats and there are a lot of comments on people living with disabilities. Community participation, was it inclusive? Did you just go to the rich? And Kisumu tends to have an attitude skewed towards the rich and leaving out those that are disadvantaged. There was a question on how the participation was done. Someone is interested in the list of stakeholders that were consulted. I don't think we want to announce it here, but maybe privately you could respond to that. There's a suggestion on using the SACO model in mobilizing the informal public transport operators. And then there is one that perhaps I'd like you to answer from Robert Schroeder. What are the risks anticipated in this plan? And what are the mitigation strategies? For example, vandalism is certainly something to consider in our cities. So would you want to comment on the risks and mitigation and the issue of inclusivity, kindly? I don't know who to give this to.
I can respond to that, Rehab. On the risks that could come up. One is, Robert Schroeder has put it, vandalism is a major issue. You find that on many occasions, streetlights are vandalized, bollards. If dustbins are provided, they are often vandalized. But I think this one requires that the security issues are addressed. First of all, even having the street lighting itself is a major, it will address the issue of vandalism because most vandalism occurs where it's dark. And also enforcement. The county has quite a lot of work to do in terms of protecting these assets. Another risk is the issue of changes in political leadership. Right now, we have very good political leadership that is embracing the issue of sustainable transport and owning the process. Sometimes things can change and you have different type of leadership. We hope that we'll continue having the political leadership that will embrace what the plan envisages and also that the budgetary allocations are available to for implementation of the projects that are proposed in the plan. Also, another risk that I can foresee is the growth of motorcycles. The numbers are growing very fast. And this can become a challenge like it has happened in many countries. And I think it's an issue that needs to be addressed in terms of policies, in terms of also improving other modes of transport so that the issue of borders and the issues of road safety associated with borders are addressed. And also the training of the riders needs to be addressed so that this road safety issues are reduced. There's also the issue of encroachment where the NMTs are constructed. We often find that other motorized users want to use to park on the NMTs or even drive on the NMTs. And this needs to be enforced by the county. It's a very serious issue, and it can actually be enforced. And also, apart from the enforcement, the design should be such that it discourages that encroachment, that the parking or driving on the NMT by using the bollards or raising the footpath above the carriageway. There's also the resistance to change. Yeah, there can be a lot of resistance to change. I know, like in the Kisumu Triangle, there was that cycle track, and there was a lot of resistance, and it had to be removed. This is going to be experienced, and unless we really sensitize the people, the residents, everybody, the stakeholders, such that we have a good, everybody embraces the sustainable transport, and we all start to understand why we are saying the city is not for the cars. The city is for Kisumu residents, and Kisumu residents need to be given the space to enjoy the city, to be safe in their city, to walk safely, to use public transport, good, comfortable public transport, the kind of public transport that our leaders see in the developed countries. Let us have it in Kisumu City. So the issue of resistance will be there, and it is very important that these sensitization programs are started almost immediately so that everybody is reading from the same page. Thank you very much.
I think a main thing underpinning that question is, who owns Kisumu? If residents of Kisumu do not take ownership, it doesn't matter what is said, but that's a question that needs to be answered broadly and very specifically to some of those issues. There's an observation here. Do you know that Kenha and the EAC partners are preparing to do a ring road around the lake? Did the team take this into account? Chris, or I don't know who?
Yes, we are aware of that project. And I think this is similar to a lot of the recent highway developments that have happened in Kisumu, that we need to make sure that when these highway corridors meet the urban area, that they take on a different cross section, you know, so that they're no longer designed with rural cross sections, but they actually start to have footpaths, cycle tracks, and so on. And so I think that's something where we need, and the county could work with Kenha to review those designs and make sure that, you know, wherever that corridor comes into the built up areas in Kisumu and elsewhere in the county, that the design reflects all the road users who are present on those respective stretches of that ring road around the lake.
Okay, thank you. On inclusivity, I think I just want to reassure the person who asked this question. Were persons with disabilities included in the stakeholder meetings? The National Commission for Equality, Gender and Equality is very concerned. Just give a yes or no so that we rest that one, that it was not an elitist participation, that it was not exclusive, but it was inclusive. Thank you.
Answer is yes. But I think that we need to make sure that all, you know, people with disabilities are brought into the discussions around projects like the Kisumu Triangle, because I think when, you know, when the city faced pressure to remove the bike lanes, you know, one of the consequences is that the, you know, many people are using, for instance, the three-wheeled, tricycles to move around are no longer able to have that protected space. You know, because when we had talked to people who, you know, people with disabilities who are using mobility assistive devices, many of them, you know, could benefit from having a complete cycle network, right? And so we need to make sure that that's part of the design for all these street corridors to enable people to move around easily.
Thank you. Timothy Mwangi has provided a load of recommendations and observations. I'm sure those will be picked. They are not questions. I don't see any new hands. Professor, did you want to make an intervention again? Or is this the old one? Okay. I'm not seeing any new interventions. And wondering whether people have exhausted their observations.
Okay, that's a thing.
Yes.
I was saying there is a kind of a study that has been undertaken on productive and livable cities. So if they can look at the activities that took place, the study was undertaken in Morogoro, Tanzania, Eldoret in Kenya, and Nairobi. They tend to emphasize issues that relate to what happens. Is our city going to remain the way it is, or with the time they have plans, one, like for example, where they will decentralize away from the central business. Like a case of Eldoret, you'll find that initially the University of Eldoret was not all that active, but today there is an unmotorized a walkway all the way from the central business district to University of Eldoret, almost 10 kilometers. So what we are saying here is, do we only look at it within this particular time spell, or do we have other future plans like Dr. Orlando put it, whereby we are saying that the town might decentralize away from the CBD. Thank you. Thank you. Those are my comments.
Thank you, Professor. I think, again, you're touching on integrated planning, long-term planning, linking various initiatives. And that's something that the team, I'm sure, has looked into or will look into. Because if you don't look at what has been happening, then you may lose out on some important information. And thank you for that. Any other intervention?
Yes, may I make a small comment?
Yes.
Madam Chair. Yeah. My name is Wachendo. I'm here more or less on a personal initiative. I work for African Development Bank, and I'm in charge of the BRT development in Dar es Salaam. So I, when I was invited, I decided to stay on and hear what you have to say about Kisumu, which is very interesting and very encouraging. Now, I heard that the consultants have classified the BRT as, is it long-term or is it medium-term? In other words, it's a little bit farther away, but the city seems to want it sooner. So I wanted to hear from the consultant, what was his reasoning for pushing it a little farther? I do understand the reasoning for the city to bring it today. Could you tell us the technical reasons why you did that? And then we can have a small discussion on that. Thank you.
Chris, was it long-term, medium-term, immediate? Is it a political project? Is it a people's project?
Sure, yeah, thanks for the question. So, yeah, we originally pushed for this to be implemented soon, because when, you know, Kenha has recently upgraded the Kisumu Boys Mamboleo corridor, and before the construction on that corridor started, we along with the county were advocating for including the BRT as part of those ongoing road works. And when the both the World Bank and Kenha were not able to include the BRT in the first phase of that construction. And so at that point we thought, okay, the BRT may not be able to happen right now on that corridor, but we could include, we could definitely start to work on the industry consolidation to improve the service quality and tackle the fleet renewal and other aspects of the public transport improvements. So that's the background. So yeah, I think it mainly requires a negotiation with the national government, because this is a Kenha corridor, and we would need to have some resolution between the county and Kenha on the way forward for the BRT. But in terms of, you know, the corridor has very high passenger demand, as Engineer and Jerry showed, 4,500 passengers per hour in the morning peak. Demand is growing, and so in terms of, from a technical standpoint, it makes a lot of sense to, you know, to allocate the road space to public transport.
Thank you for that response. George Olual, your hand is up. Kindly make your intervention. George Olual, are you still with us? Still connected?
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. I'm George Olual. I'm MCF for Kolwa Central and also the chair of Planning and Industrialization Committee in Kisumu Assembly. We have been in this webinar with my committee, and we first of all want to appreciate ITDP and Ford Foundation for the good initiative for our county. And also thank the consultant for the good participatory process that they have undertaken to realize this project becomes a success. And more so on the way they did their data, they captured their data and statistics. I saw some quality in it. And about accessibility and inclusivity, I had seen that there was so much concentration on the CBD, I don't know, especially on the Kisumu Triangle. I don't know whether the, when you talk about accessibility and inclusivity, I think we have people who commute from the estates, and some of them may be having physical challenges like the PWDs. When we do when we do these bicycle tracks only and CBD, how does that maybe mitigate their conditions? Do we see that they have been neglected in this process? So, because mobility should be from the estates also to the central business district. And also, I've heard people talking about decongestion. It is true that Kisumu County, Kisumu City is more of a monocentric, and you find that we have a lot of traffic towards town center in the morning and a lot of traffic from city center to the estates in the evening. Maybe we should work in a way to maybe decongest the city by maybe creating other centers within the Kisumu city, so that we not only have people coming to town in the morning and going to the estates in the evening. Maybe more of what someone said about integrated planning. And also about gender mainstreaming. We had seen that 60% of women are working towards walking to work. And now that maybe if is there a plan to maybe look into their safety, so that maybe as they walk to work, we can also do something on the security and safety. And also maybe now this on Kisumu County, mostly the executive, that maybe we can also enforce people to walk on the footbridges, because we have footbridges in Kachok and Nyamasaria, but you still find people crossing on the busy Nairobi highway, and it's not good for safety. And again, on safety, I've not heard something said about maybe emergency mobility. How do we ensure that when there is an emergency, we can get the fire stations maybe up to the slum areas, especially when there is where there is traffic congestion. And I must appreciate that. I must also appreciate that much has been talked about, especially on the technical dimension of innovations, especially on transport modes, using the BRTs and automating the parking. But I've not heard so much about maybe mobility as a service and shared transport. Otherwise, lastly, is about the financial aspect of it. This will involve a lot of sunk costs. Do we have a plan maybe to fund this project so that it becomes a reality? Otherwise, thank you.
Thank you, George, for your observations, your questions, your comments. I'm sure some are ongoing discussions and negotiations. This is just a framework for the next couple years. They always say the devil is in the details. And for that, we depend highly on MCAs and people in the county assembly to pass budgets, to prioritize some of the things that you're talking about. But I'd also want to give it to the consultants to respond to some of the things they picked from your contribution. Thank you.
Yeah, hi. Maybe I could respond to a couple of points and then hand it over to colleagues. So for the question about the concentration on the CBD, we did try to prioritize a number of walking and cycling improvements throughout the built up area of the city. So the first and second phase and third phase NMT improvements are not just in the CBD, but we would definitely invite you, George, to, you know, if there are certain priority corridors that you think are important to include, or, you know, or we should change the order of how these would be developed, then definitely let us know. And it's easy to update the phasing plan for the NMT improvements. And for the points about, you know, a couple of people have raised the points about the decentralization, like number one, the point that was raised earlier about the, you know, other areas in the metro area expanding, like Ahero is becoming more developed, more people are, you know, trips are, you know, the urban area is basically expanding. So I think that trend, those trends will happen, but what's really important is we make sure that growth is centered around public transport. You know, so these node, you know, each node where the urban development is happening has good access to frequent public transport and also good walking and cycling facilities, so that we're not just getting a low density sprawl that's very hard to serve with sustainable modes. And this is already happening. You know, there are nodes like Kondele that's almost becoming a second CBD in the city. And so we need to see how we can strengthen those linkages so that people have direct access to these emerging nodes. And then finally, for the mobility as a service, you know, for all these sorts of shared road services, I think shared services, we need to find out how to make sure that they complement sustainable modes. So for instance, with, you know, with services like Uber or, you know, Boda Bodas, sometimes they're running parallel to public transport, so they're actually competing with public transport, but sometimes they're actually complementing public transport, so they're feeding into it. And so we need to have better data on these services to know how they're operating, you know, and what are they, you know, are the trips that people are taking with them trips that could be done on public transport if we had a better public transport system, or do they really need to be made on these modes, and they're actually supporting the use of sustainable mobility? So those are a few comments from my side.
Okay.
Engineer Jerry, sorry. Mitao, please.
Okay, thanks, Chris, for the good comments. So to add something on about the financial support, the financial aspect, you know, all projects, this is one of the main issues. And for this plan to be a success, there is need to have that good allocation of budget. This is a good thing that there's good political will on implementing the plan. But then we need to get adequate funding for these projects from the national government, and also from the city government and the county assembly. I think can be able to enforce that in the allocation of budget for the provision of the NMT infrastructure. So I think the county assembly can be able to push for adequate allocation of budget to make improvements in the NMT infrastructure, and also to make these improvements in the public transport. Yeah.
Thank you, Gita. I want to comment on gender mainstreaming, on making the streets safer for women. We have touched on that in the plan, on the issue of improving the street lighting. In fact, where the streets are well lit, you find that the businesses can continue for longer periods of time, and everybody, including women and even children, can be able to move around and feel safe as they walk around. On the issue of footbridges, Chris talked about that in the presentation. Mheshimiwa, you talked about the footbridges which are existing, but people are not using them. Indeed, that's what happens everywhere, even in Nairobi. Footbridges consume a lot of public resources, but they are not user-friendly. They are not universally accessible. They are not accessible to people with disability. And when we talk about people with disability, we are talking about people with physical challenges. It could be maybe somebody with a visual disability, somebody who is using a wheelchair, an expectant mother, or a lady who is having children, carrying children. It's very difficult to climb up. Some of the footbridges, like the one on Nairobi Highway, is very high up. It could be like 7 meters up there. It's very high. So for people to get up there, it's quite strenuous. And actually, sometimes it is almost impossible for some of the users to who are expected to use the footbridge to actually use the footbridge. So footbridges are actually not user-friendly. And we discourage the use of footbridges. We recommend that the crossings, we should have safe, well-designed crossings, which are at grade, which are accessible to all the road users. And in addition to that, we should reduce the speeds of the vehicles in the urban areas. It is indeed in the Traffic Act. The Traffic Act is very clear on that, that in the urban areas, we should not have any vehicles which are moving at speeds higher than 50 kilometers per hour. And we actually advocate for even less, about 30 kilometers per hour. So the design of the urban roads should be such that we are reducing the speeds of the vehicles which are in the urban areas, and also providing safe crossings and minimizing the distance. Like in the presentation, there was that the children crossing very wide lanes. We should minimize the crossing distance and have tabletop crossings, which provide universal access, and also they reduce the speed of vehicles. On emergency response, yes, that we may need to add a section on that. We need, and especially in the informal settlement, the main issue normally is that the roads within the informal settlements are too narrow, and the emergency vehicles are not able to reach maybe a place where there's a fire or an emergency of other sort. So we will liaise with the county government and identify the suitable proposals that are achievable in the city with respect to emergency response. And thank you very much, Mheshimiwa, for attending this presentation with your team. That is very encouraging. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those responses. I see that we have about 8 minutes to 1 o'clock. And yet I do not want to lock anybody out. Safe to say that this is a framework. There will be details when we come to e-mobility. I see a lot of questions. Is e-mobility going to lock out the poor? Those are discussions about costs, the opportunity cost of going for e-mobility vis-a-vis the current polluting vehicles that we are using. Those are discussions and debates that I see going beyond this session. There's also a caution from, I think this is a person who lives in the UK, Dom Cox. He's saying, be careful not to borrow all the technology from Europe. Make sure the buses are manufactured in Kenya and bicycles too. Think about employment creation as you bring in different technology. So there's a lot of good advice on the side chats, and I'm sure the group will pick a lot of that and synthesize it together with the county. Do we have one person who must say something before we close? This is your time. Briefly.
Rahab, I think Engineer Kevin Ajul wanted to make some comments.
Oh, sorry, I missed that. Engineer, yeah. Kindly do that, sorry. I had called out and I think they were off, so I don't know. Engineer, are you with us?
Yes, I am here. You getting me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you. And thanks for the opportunity. I just wanted to make some few comments. Mheshimiwa mentioned mobility within the estates, ensuring that people can
Hello, Kevin. I think he's dropped off. Sorry about that. So I'm not sure he's with us. He's dropped off again. Kelvin? Sorry, he may be having connectivity challenges. Chris, I think we've lost him.
I think, yeah, maybe the connection's not working.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, no, he's gone off.
Okay, just asking, any other person who feels they want to say something? Otherwise, most of the comments on the chats will be taken on board by the group, by ITDP. Of course, this is an ongoing living conversation with Kisumu County. The document is yet to be presented to the cabinet for their adoption. So this is not the end. And if you feel you have comments that must get to ITDP, their details will be left on the screen so that you can write to them in the quickest time possible, and they'll be able to incorporate your good feedback. One last question, one last chance. Any person who feels I left them out or did not see their hand, or they must say this before we close?
Mine probably is just to follow up on Mr. Wakwendo's of African Development Bank. And they reiterated that this proposal on implementation of BRT, the governor and city manager had already approached His Excellency the President to see if we could get some funding to it. And we are very keen to have this as part, as already expressed by the Director for Urban Development. And probably we want you, if there's any way you can support us, because the reason as to why probably this wasn't taken up is because we didn't have ready designs. But had it been that we had the designs with us, then probably we would have already started working on it. But there's a lot of interest, and you invited, probably we can engage further on this.
Thank you, Engineer Sule, for that emphasis. And we will take it up, because we would like to see Kisumu move to the next level in terms of a reformed public transport system. Do we have anyone who would like to give some closing remarks from Kisumu County? As we prepare, I just want to congratulate ITDP. Always proud to work with you and to partner with you. We value your high level of professionalism. Thank you, Kisumu County, for the resilience since 2016. We've come to almost the end of producing a framework that will guide sustainable urban mobility in Kisumu. Let's try and reorganize, reprioritize, negotiate to ensure that something is done in the short term. Engineer Sule, I again want to assure you of the support that we'd like to give with the planning process. And just to mention that with these kinds of public transport systems, the planning is critical. It could take not just 2 months, but 2 years. But once you get it right, the rest of it sails through very, very smoothly. So I hand it over to Kisumu County for someone to give a vote of thanks, and we'll close the session. Thank you.
Director Gome, please. We've lost Kevin, so you do it on our behalf.
Okay, thanks very much for the time we've had today on this webinar. We particularly want to thank ITDP, who have really worked with us all the way from 2016. And already we can see some of the quick wins that we are already deriving from this plan. However, in as much as it has not been formally presented for the approval by the various authorities within the county, but already we've extracted, we had anticipated and extracted a bit of it, and that's why we are doing NMT within the city center, and soon we are also extending it out even to the residential areas. Otherwise, as we've stated, we think BRT is not only just a political project as it may be seen, but something that the governor has a vision for. Initially, he had thought that we could actually have trams instituted within the next 5 years of his governance, but due to the technical advice we've gotten here and there, in terms of cost, and in terms of even the immediate implementation may be a problem, but we think BRT is something that can almost be a quick win, in as much as it also needs some time for preparation and also the technical aspect it has and the financial capability to implement. So we thank you very much, even as we move forward to form the mobility steering committee, that will definitely help us do all the other plans that have been recommended in the plan, that we keep intact and keep in contact so that each and every time we can actually consult, so that we have this vision actually actualized by the county government and the Kisumu city in particular. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Engineer Gomez. Any announcements from ITDP? Or any last word, or do we call it a day?
Let me take this opportunity to thank everybody for finding time to attend this webinar. It's your input are very important, and we are going to incorporate them in the draft to come up with a final draft. And we are going to also now present to the cabinet very soon. And after that, hopefully the plan can be approved and the implementation process can commence or continue, because it's like already started. So we are going to share the meeting notes, the minutes of this meeting with all the participants and the presentation. And even after we finalize the plan, we will share the final copy of the plan. Thank you very much for attending.